Alright, hello everyone. Welcome back to Persona. I am SIMSteven, also known as Master Fenral. And screw this dungeon to hell. And that's simply because this dungeon, I never expected this game to be this trolly with their dungeon design. I mean, just take a look at this area outside of the save points. And this long, convoluted maze of pathways starts out like a ladder, kind of goes all the way around, comes back around, and you kind of have to zigzag around once again. Then you have to go upstairs. Well, that initially starts on the third floor, but coming from like the second floor and the third floor, this dungeon is just been a pain in the ass, really. I mean, I think that staircase leads from the third floor, and then it goes down, well, then you go down to the first floor from there, then you come back up around, I think, over here. This goes all the way around and around and around. It's just been one of those absolutely trollous dungeons, because even though you start up at the third floor, go all the way down the first, and then all the way back to the third, and then you continue on up to the fifth floor, taking those staircases, that all was nothing more than one long dead end. So, yeah, screw this dungeon. Either way, I plan to try and get at least some more progress done. The only path we've never been on has been right here on the third floor. So we take the elevator up and we're in new territory. And there's just this one big kind of clearing area here. And this is apparently the area we should have gone in the first place. So there's a door here. It's locked. Guido is not here. Oh. And the only other thing we can do here is potentially take another trap door. A la the Karma Palace. So, where is this gonna dump us out on? I have no idea. And, at least in my defense, I'm at least playing through this game semi-blind. At this point, it's been a very blind let's play, because honestly, I thought this game wasn't gonna be this bad with their dungeon design up to this point. And that's simply because when I had initially played this game years ago and gotten as far as I did, I had gotten just before the subway in the other dimension. And honestly, the dungeon design up to that point was, I don't know, most of the dungeons could be done in about an hour or so, and it didn't take me literal hours just trying to get through one pathway only to find it was a dead end. So honestly, I'm surprised the game ended up turning out this way with how jerk it was with the dungeon design later in the game. And wow, those make louder noises than I remember. I don't even remember if I actually fought these guys or not at all. I think I might have gotten their card once. Ooh. Well, should they reflect winds? Either way, I might end up just using spell cards, because I got most of the spell cards of the monsters in this dungeon up to this point. So I could start just making everything run away so I could get through this and kind of coast my way through this dungeon. But yeah, as I was saying, in past playthroughs of this game, pretty much the longest dungeon before the subway probably would have been the Sebek Corporation building, and honestly, it didn't feel like that long in my memory, and even replaying it for this LP. It's just, oh, I'm back here. What good did that do? What good did that do? Do we actually have to find something on like a wall or something? Because I think I've literally been all the way around this dungeon, and I have no idea what I'm supposed to do at this point. Well, let's actually take a look at the maps once again to see if there's any pathways I haven't been down. Yeah, And there's a trapdoor area there. Nothing down this way. Is this going to be one of those things where I actually have to look at every single wall until there's, like, one thing on the wall that I have to push, like a lever or something? Because there's only been one time I remember in the past where we actually had to do something in the actual dungeon itself, in the hallways, where we're in first-person view like this, to trigger something. And I can't go in there. There's... that's a room that's apparently been locked. So, do we actually gotta go all the way around and try and find, like, one of those NPCs in a room that might have a key or something? I have no idea. Yeah, screw this dungeon. let's see. Because when you're going around in this kind of a dungeon here, you're not really looking at the walls, you're looking at the mini-map, and you're not really keeping an eye out for, like, levers or something on the walls themselves. So, I have a feeling we may end up having to check the walls everywhere we go now, at this point, because I think we've treaded literally every part of this dungeon, and I have not found a car or a key or anything like that. Or anything in, like, the rooms or anything like that. So what exactly are we going to have to do to finish this? I have no idea. Anywho, and yeah, even when I was remapping or backtracking from the fifth floor back to here, back to the save point, at the end of the last time, I actually did map out pretty much everything on the higher floors. It's just... it's locked. Guido is not here. And that's probably where we gotta go, eventually. So do we really have to go back down that long, convoluted pathway and maybe look for something on one of the walls? Holy crap, this dungeon. Anywho, as I was kind of saying, yeah, the Sebek Corporation probably was the longest dungeon I had been through prior to starting this LP, and like I was saying, it didn't feel like one dungeon, it felt more like three, because of all the events that happened, including even if you count the school, because you kind of get dumped out in the school, and not long after that, you're forced into the school dungeon. So, that's kind of a thing. Is that I never expected the dungeons to get as long as they have. I mean, I never expected to spend 2.5 hours going down one long pathway, only to find that it was a dead end, like we did here. And I could see, like, the Karma Palace having sort of a gimmick before. You know, how it's a trapdoor gimmick and you have to eventually find your way through. And... well, that was the first instance of a really long dungeon that we encountered. And that looks suspicious. so I'm going to have to go down every hallway here, I guess, until we find... I would really love to contact you and get a spell card or something, but... these guys are just the most annoying encounter in here. but yeah, the Carmen's Palace was the first instance of a really long dungeon that we had to go through, and it's like literally after I stopped, well, the subway doesn't really count because it's the passageway that they go through a few times, so it was kind of short, but literally after I stopped with each playthrough that I made in this game, there was one dungeon right after that that ended up being a long and convoluted pathway. So, I was not expecting this game to be a dungeon-crawling, grind-heavy game that it became. It's just... all of a sudden, it just became a paving ass as soon as I get to use the parts that I don't recognize. Or don't know what's going on here. And honestly, I was also thinking off-screen, you know... when I was listening to myself talk about, well, I was doing my editing at least, when I was listening to myself talk about the, whether or not I thought this place might be the final dungeon, I actually did go and look at one of the guides. Didn't look, you know, how to solve the dungeon or anything like that, because that would kind of ruin the blind experience here. But I did look like at the table of contents at the top of the guide, and well, kind of unfortunately, is that it's not the final dungeon, but we're actually a couple sections away from the end of the game. So honestly, I'm kind of glad at that, because it's kind of been hard to make some of these videos, I guess, because of just how difficult and how long some of these dungeons are, and how I'm not the best speaker and all that, you know? I mean, that should be pretty obvious and everything. Can we inspect this wall? Guess not. And I kind of have to come up with things to talk about while I'm just exploring these long-ass dungeons. I thought of this would kind of be more of a traditional RPG, where that you just do a little dungeon, and then you get a bit of story, you do another little dungeon, more story, and then rinse and repeat for X amount of events, and then eventually you would, you know, reach the end of the game, and huzzah, you save the town or the world, and or whatever you want to consider in this case. But, yeah. I was not expecting it just to be much more of a dungeon crawler in the mid to late game. It's just, that's kind of what it's gonna turn out to be. Thankfully, though, they do throw you a bone with the spell card system. Once again, I still love the contact system where you can actually talk to the monsters in the game and fuse them to make your spell system, essentially. And it's also even nicer to have the spell cards of the monsters as you go into a dungeon like this, because you can just make them run away. That's been a real nice feature of the game. So it kind of cuts down without having to resort to just, you know, an accessory that's unknown counters accessory. Even though that would be convenient and everything, it's kind of weird how, you know, there is no way to prevent encounters entirely. Because I would love to just never see a black man again in my life. because I just don't like fighting those guys. But I can at least make the enemies run away, and they actually give me items as they do. Like, we just got a medic stone there, and that's actually used to barter with other enemies. Nothing here. Okay. So, maybe that wasn't a long-ass dead end. Maybe we actually needed to check that door. Maybe now that'll trigger something with some of the NPCs in the rooms we saw on that long and convoluted pathway. I'm gonna actually kind of go straight ahead, and we're probably gonna look for some of those rooms along the way, and maybe they'll actually give us a key to Guido's room. I would really love it if that was the case. Or maybe we'll find Guido himself in a different room, but well, he's apparently in the middle of this big ass dungeon, but there's parts of the dungeon that I haven't actually explored yet. I've actually seen him on the mini map, but they just haven't been there. But now I'm actually paranoid, and I'm checking all the walls just to see if there's a lever on one of these walls. Because I've pretty much walked on every single tile up to this point, and well, it's pretty much just got to backtrack through the long-ass dead end and try and figure out where, what I missed. Oh, if I don't answer them, I can't actually contact in the fight? What? Well, this will probably be the first incubus we've ever fought. Hopefully he's not one of those enemies that exhausts all magic, which apparently he's already starting to do that with that first attack. Yeah, it looks like he absorbed everything, but at least I'm going to kill everything else in the battle. If I remember right, we never actually fought an incubus, because we contacted him the first time we ever fought one, and ever since then we've made him run away with spell cards, because we got a spell card the very first time we fought one of these things. By the way, yeah, I've been using Death Spell with Chris because it's free XP. one thing I can say that's been nice about this dungeon has been the fact that we've been actually be getting a lot of levels, which has actually been very nice in the long run, because I was very worried about how if my party was underleveled or not, considering the fact that a lot of the cards we would make, a lot of the personas we can make over in the Velvet Room have been 40 plus with the spell cards we've been getting. So it's actually been kind of nice that we've gained a few levels. And well, I haven't been back to the Velvet Room since my last recording session. In fact, off screen, I only just swapped a few weapons around. I was using a lot of weapons that were like attack alls, but they weren't multi-hits. And they had good stats on them and everything like that. And that's kind of what I've been using. Hopefully with this, with the change in the weapons I made, I'll be getting multi-hits. And maybe we'll attack the black men next time we fight them with normal attacks. And see if that makes the fights go any faster. Because I don't even know if it's possible to run from those black men or not. They kind of seem like the enemy that you don't want to encounter when you're in a long dungeon like this, but they're going to show up anyways. And yeah, checking the walls. I'm just using my eyes this time. I'm not going to go all the way around, just because the more I walk, the less dead ends I walk down, the less encounters I get into. So we're just going to try and speed through this and try to figure out what we got to do in this damn dungeon. But yeah, I've equipped a bunch more multi-hit weapons to see if that'll take down Black Man a little bit faster than whatever I've been doing with like the attack all spells. But that might end up being the best way to take care of these guys. Yeah, a lot of those weapons I've been using, though, had better stats than what I've got overall, just like better luck, better power, better strength, better vitality, stuff like that. That was the reason I was using them, because I'm relying on my personas more than my weapons these days. but yeah. Ain't nothing down that way. So, anyways, I may end up just start cutting fights a little bit more, because I'm either going to be contacting and making them run away, or just auto-battling against, like, the black men, because those are about the only enemies I don't have the cards from, at least until we get back to the higher levels, that is. Because we had some new monsters encounters up in the higher levels. But, you know, we might start doing a bit more blocking. Well, these guys I don't have their spell cards from, but they have not been much of a threat. They absorb physicals, as I found out last time. But they're actually very weak against magic, and with this auto battle setup that I got right now, where I'm just casting attack all magic, it's pretty much been very good at decimating their numbers. But yeah, I might just start a little blog going on here, because, like I said before, I kind of got to find things to talk about when I'm doing these long-ass dungeons. So, one thing I thought up of talking about while we'll go through this thing again is actually to talk about other dungeon crawler type games I've played before in the past. One of my favorite dungeon crawler games actually has been on the PS1 as well. Big surprise and all that. But it's a game by Square. Goes by the name of Vagrant Story. And I got back attacked by a bunch of clones there. But Vagrant Story is probably one of my top dungeon crawly type games. And it's very interesting that, you know, I'm kind of bringing up the topic of dungeon crawler type games while I'm playing a dungeon crawler game, because Vagrant Story is a game I consider to have done it right. Alright, that was a fight against three black men, and no, melee attacks aren't as good as using my personas, unfortunately. So there goes that plan. And I'm not even really going to... I don't know if I really want to fully explore all of the first floor again. So let's just kind of get up to the higher floors and see if there's anything over that way. I will check out these little pathways, like this one right here, and see if there's any levers or anything for me to hit. And there's not. But yeah, as I was talking about with Vagrant Story, well, where to begin with how to describe this game? Vagrant Story takes place in a single city, but it's got this dark underground cavernous labyrinth, I guess I should say, and it's just teeming with monsters and everything, and you're an agent of the Crown who has come to investigate a cult who's made their headquarters there because they attacked one of the VIP officials in the world of Vagrant Story. And because a VIP of the Crown got attacked, you're basically sent to go hunt down, I guess, their leader, maybe the rest of the cult as well. But as an agent of the Crown, you already start off being this highly trained professional, because you wouldn't be an agent of the Crown to begin with unless you were, you know, this badass that you are. And the dude's name is Ashley. Just gotta say, that's kind of weird for a guy's name. But, you know, he's the kind of guy you wouldn't make fun of his name because he's an absolute badass. However, the name of the protagonist aside, he is an absolute badass, but at the same time, he's basically... he's basically kind of got that assassin's emotion set, in that he is completely unaffected by a lot of the things that he has to deal with throughout the course of the game. I mean, literally, as soon as he gets into this town where the cultists are hiding, he kind of gets locked in as a result of an earthquake, and then all of a sudden, zombies start raising from the ground. And the dude just kind of handles it without it even batting an eye. He just, all of a sudden, he sees all these weird oddities and monsters cropping up all over the place, and things kind of get weirder and weirder as he goes. And it kind of goes from, you know, your standard mustard fare, a bunch of zombies and stuff like that, maybe a slime or a bat here and there, and just as he goes farther and farther to the city, he starts fighting stronger and stronger monsters as you go. So it starts out, like I said, with, you know, some of your standard monsters, zombies, bats, wolves, and stuff that might be considered normal. Well, zombies, I guess, not so much being a normal thing, but eventually you get to your first boss, and that's a freaking minotaur, and it's like, ooh, I'm dead. Nope. Takes care of it like a boss. But as you go through the game, you fight stronger and stronger monsters. So you go from a minotaur to a golem, to a dragon, and then, you know, stronger and stronger monsters keep coming up. And as you get further and further into the city, you fight stranger and stranger things, like possessed demon marionette dolls, and, you know, elemental monsters and stuff like that. And it's not normal to see these things in the world that the game is placed in. At least I don't think it is. Vagrant Story is, I think, loosely connected to Final Fantasy Tactics. So the monsters are there out in the world if you've played Final Fantasy Tactics, but a lot of it becomes a lot more creepy as you go, and there's just lots of dungeons to go through, and it's broken up by story bits here and there. And what floor are we on now? Second floor. Alright, still have not found anything of interest. What's the fastest way around here, by the way? I I'm not going to go down that way just yet. I would like to just kind of get up to the third floor at this point and get through as quickly as possible. Let's see, what's the way forward? Straight? Yeah, we'll skip out on the second floor for the time being and just kind of get to the third floor. Kind of looking at the floor a bit more as well, because there was that circular pattern in front of the room that Guido supposedly is in. Because I think that circle in the ground might be a bit of a clue for stuff that I should watch out in here. But yeah, anyways, back to Vagrant Story. So, you know, the characters even make a point to say that, you know, the dead getting up and walking around is not a normal occurrence. So it might be slightly detached from the world of Final Fantasy, I guess, or Final Fantasy Tactics, that is. Because you do fight skeletons as just regular monsters in the encounters in that game. So it's just like zombies and stuff walking around in the world of Vagrant Story. Yeah, it's kind of a weird thing that they would say that, you know, this is not a normal occurrence. To have zombies wandering around and stuff like that. Alright. I think I'm gonna just head for the rooms that are along the way. And I'm gonna at least check some of these dead ends here on the third floor, since this is the floor where Guido's room is. Alright. It has been nice having just being able to bait all the monsters in a way. Because we're getting through this a lot faster than last time. Gotta say that at least. Anyways, what's in here? Let's actually talk to the people in here a second time now that we've checked that door. Kind of wondering if any of these NPCs will give me a key. Everyone's repeating themselves, I kind of am too. key? Please. You must be brainwashed. Alright, I guess nothing's here. Alright, nothing new. Alright, so either way, back to what I was saying. Wow, the music changed slightly there a second ago. I skipped that pathway there. Hopefully I didn't miss anything there, but eventually I might have to come back this way anyways. So let's get on with it again. So anyways, even though it is a bit of a dungeon crawler, Vagrant Story that is, I really liked playing through the game. It was very hard, especially on the first playthrough. But eventually you can get so overpowered that you can just breeze through the game in a matter of hours if you want to. In fact, it even has its own internal achievement system where it actually expects you to beat the game without saving or just beat it under 10 hours. And I actually did that, did a run where I just kind of went through and breezed through the game as quickly as possible. Once I built some of the best gear that I possibly could equip, and well, there's no shop system or anything. You literally are just you versus the monsters, and you make stuff in workshops. There's no shopkeepers or anything. It's pretty much the only characters in the game who you can interact with are a couple of enemies, especially a bunch of churchgoers, because you're more of a vigilante, I guess, in their eyes. Well, the church has their own agenda with the city itself, as you'll find out. But they consider you to be an enemy. Speaking of which, it does sound a lot like Final Fantasy Tactics, because you fight the church in Final Fantasy Tactics as well. at least eventually you do, but yeah, reason using the same things. But eventually, you explore the city. And why am I showing this fight? And as you explore the city, you realize there's something more at play than just a cultist witch hunt, which was the original reason you got sent there. that looked kind of weird as I was approaching it, which is kind of why I bumped into the wall there. I'm gonna check this a little bit here. Alright, back to the fourth floor it is. I guess this is where we're supposed to go in the first place. I just must have missed something. What did I miss? well, there were areas over here which I couldn't go down through. Well, I saw them on the mini-map at least. And I think that was that door there, that room there, is the last one that has NPCs in it. So I'm going to go straight to that and see. Now that we've checked the room that has the, apparently has Guido in it, I'm probably going to talk to the NPCs in there and see if they have anything new to say. So anyways, as you're going through the game of Vagrant Story, you eventually go against the church and pretty much align yourself with the cultists instead, the guys you were actually supposed to go and hunt down in the first place. But that's mostly because the main antagonist, or the main leader, I guess, of the cultists wanted you to come there in the first place. Either way, you're about the only guy here who isn't one of the black men. Nope. I guess there's nothing in these rooms. So I think at this point we're probably going to go up to the fifth floor and work our way back down and see if there's a lever up there somewhere. Just going to check down the hallways we haven't checked at this point. Anywho. So yeah, the leader of the cultists basically slowly and surely reveals to you the secrets of the city that you've been exploring up to that point. And how the whole deal with the city is that it had been hit by an earthquake many years ago, and everyone who lived in this city ended up dying as a result of it. I think either the earthquake itself killed them, or just the fact that the city itself had essentially been cut off from the outside world because it's surrounded by water, and ever since that earthquake hit, you couldn't access the city anymore because it's surrounded by water and there are vicious whirlpools surrounding the water after the earthquake hit. So, I guess people either died as a result of the earthquake or as of starvation. Yet the twist in all this is that, despite the fact that you can access the city through one underground passageway, and that's kind of where the dungeon crawling aspect, I guess, comes from. Because for the most part, you're going to be underground, and the church primarily inhabits the surface of the world. The surface of the city, and to navigate around the church, you're pretty much going to be fighting monsters in the underground, and as things go, you'll learn, you know, there's more to the story than just chasing down a cult. And to kind of make the long story short, the earthquake was as a result of some magic. And killing all the people in the city was a result of some sort of ritual, which the VIP that got attacked in the beginning, that sent you on this wild goose chase to begin with, he had a hand in the massacre of all these people, and as a result, you kind of get roped into something that you never planned to get roped into, and it ultimately results not only in this major conspiracy between the VAP, but, finally, a lever. This is what I should have hit a long time ago, and why did I not see this before? So, can I go to Guido's place now? I mean, it may end up checking the walls all the way back once again. But anyways, as I was saying, the whole plot of the game, well, I don't want to spoil the ending or anything, but overall it just becomes this massive conspiracy theory plot in you know, who was fighting over the power of the city. Because the ritual which caused the earthquake flooded the city with dark magic power, and a lot of different groups are fighting over the power of the city. And let's see here. I guess that's it, finally. I'm gonna have pretty much... Ooh. A new route has appeared. That was not there before. Okay. Now that we hit that level, we can go down this hallway. I guess maybe get a key to Guido's room? So yeah, ultimately it wraps up becoming this, what's going on here? See a dead end over there. And a big open room here. Alright, another lever, I guess? Are we just going to open one more path after another on our way back down? Is that what this is going to be? Oh. Suddenly a trap door? And I'm glad I checked my map a second ago, because I noticed there's a trap door right in front of us that wasn't there a second ago when we walked over this pathway here. Alright, so, I'm guessing this leads back out if we were to go down to the save point, so let's continue on this path here. Yeah, I'm thinking I'll keep going down this pathway, which I'm assuming this will lead back up to the fifth floor, because there were parts of it, the fifth floor, we haven't discovered yet that I saw on the minimap a second ago. Yeah. So... not missing any hidden levers, am I? This looks like an important room. Let's heal up before doing so. Can't do anything probably with my personas. I'm still only level 70. As well as Cerberus. You know what? I'm gonna have him change over to Crow, because Cerberus has not been that great of a persona. Even though I was going crazy how it was like the only fortune arcane persona. Magic cast. Let's heal up real quick. Alright, and good to go. So what's in this room? Oh, just some scientists. Okay, so it's not a boss fight. All these guys went crazy. Has everybody here been brainwashed? No, we saw one guy down below who wasn't completely brainwashed. We must stop Guido as soon as possible. And Chris silent as ever. Alright, loot. Opal. I think that's a fusion item. Amethyst, precious gems like that you can trade at that one shop that has the guys in the face paint in the Japanese. They look like they're from a Japanese play or something like that. Either way, humans don't deserve to have a future.
Judgment day has come. All humans will suffer.
Why humans exist? What is our purpose? Why are these guys all pondering the meaning of life? Weird. Anyway, some spell rocks? I think those are like healing items, I think? If I'm not mistaken. Hallway, nothing? What? Well, anyways, as I was trying to do, to wrap up a long story short about Vagrant Story's plot, is that you have a bunch of groups fighting over power. Not land or money or political power or anything like that. But literally just magic power that has been unleashed in this one city as a result of a giant ritual. And as a result of that, Ashley being like the one guy who is more or less neutral in this conflict, he has a special role to play in the grand scheme of the story, and, well, as a result, he gains a lot of the power of the city, because just being in the city itself allows people to perform the supernatural and learn to use magic and stuff like that, because of that whole ritual that was performed. And so the cultist has some special... What is this? Red lights? The floor turned red in front of me. I am freaked out about that. That is kind of freaky how it does this. What happens if I step off of that? Oh, is it a puzzle? Let me guess, that door over there won't open unless we turn all the tiles red. Is that what this is? I kind of know how to solve these puzzles. I think that does it. I think I got them all red. This doesn't open. That place looks suspicious. Must be something there. Oh, do we have to turn them all off? Is that what it is? Well, it's simply just a matter of going back and forth, for the most part. Also, just let's undo this one. Okay. Let's turn you back off. It's just more so a matter of clearing one hallway, or clearing off all the side areas, and then just kind of working your way backwards. Oh, I think I actually get it. I noticed that the ceiling itself has the red dot, so it's not making them all off or turning them all on. It's making it so the only red dots on the ceiling are the ones that are lit on the floor. Okay. So these two I need to turn on. And that's it. Yeah, I heard a ding go just there, and it went unding. Yeah, there we go. Alright. Puzzle done. Bingo! Okay, simple enough, and there were no encounters during all that, so I guess maybe the sixth floor doesn't have any encounters on it? I guess. But yeah, either way, to finish the story before we go into this clearly ominous door, yeah, there was a bunch of groups fighting for power and all that, and Ashley himself was like the only neutral party in that, and he has a special role to play in it all, but I don't know, I might talk more about it in the future, but we probably got some story events to do in this game, so let's go through it and see what's here.